Yes, I come out good. Evening. Very evening. I'm going to basically introduce some ideas of quantum mechanics before we actually go to SIM school, because in SIM school we have Professor Michel going to be speaking on various ideas in quantum mechanics involving different areas of mathematics. So it's a good idea to have some bits of quantum mechanics before you get to those lectures. This is essentially some undergraduate materials. So how many of you have actually done quantum mechanics? Okay. See my students there. So essentially it's a good idea. I'm not like the other speakers before, where they look at a lot of examples, but I'm just going to give you some ideas. Okay, what are the algebraic structures actually being used in quantum mechanics? I'm going to forget other parts of the quantum mechanics, like there are a lot of functional analysis involved, but I'm not going to touch those. Right. So essentially, this is the outline of lecture. There will be about five different ideas. I'm not sure. I might just trickle to the next lecture as well. Okay. Because the other lecture, second one after this, essentially is a shorter one. Okay. So this one will we begin by some of the physical ideas and where we actually consider some of the mathematical structures. Then we talk about quantum states, observables, and then measurements and predictions, and then some idea of dynamics. So I begin with the first one. Yeah, so this is about the physical ideas inside quantum theory. So what are essentially the key features of quantum theory? Essentially the idea of wave particle duality in some sense, okay, in the beginning, the very beginning, and where we have seen experimentally wave characteristics of particles. And this wave characteristic of particles is actually described by the idea of quantum wave functions, or in general we can talk about quantum states. Okay? And I don't need a mic, right? Sources of waves. Okay? And then they start to interfere with some kind of interference. Okay? This we actually see in high school experiments with light. But what's shown over here is actually not light. These are electrons. Okay? We normally think of electrons being particles. But in the beginning you don't see anything. Okay? But you can start to see some random dots there, and then more electrons passing through, and then finally you get this bright fringe, dark fringe. Essentially just like the kind of things that you see in a double slit experiment for photons. So these are actually electrons. And they have done this kind of experiments for other particles besides electrons, but in a less sophisticated way. This one is actually very sophisticated. To get the first double slit experiment for electrons, the experiment was done in the late 1980s in Hitachi lab. This is a phenomenal result. Okay? So it was quite difficult to do it. For light, it's quite easy. Okay? And done with the So, to describe this superposition principle is essentially the mathematical structure that's involved is the idea of vector spaces. vector, you have the idea of vectors plus vector, give you another vector. So essentially it's just that, as simple as that. So what's involved in quantum theory could be vector spaces. Okay? But there are more. Okay? There are more. So now the other key idea in quantum theory is basically probabilities. Okay? So quantum theory is actually a probabilistic theory. And where you get this idea of probability is actually through the wave function. As you probably see earlier, you can see that where the dark fish are, okay, you have low probability of black ones passing, reaching to that point. Where the bright fish are, you get more probability for the black ones to be there. Okay? So we have this idea of probability theory encoded somehow in the wave function. Okay? And one of the things that's to deal with quantum theory, even it's probability, and you learn probability on your life, it's not quite like the classical probability where you talk about relative frequency, and then you can model those like, you have a total phase space, and then you can see how much probability by looking at the relative size of phase space area that you can cover with respect to the whole phase space. Okay? But in quantum theory, the quantum probabilities are actually based on directions. Okay? So what it does is actually to use the simple idea of the sum of the square direction cosine. Okay? So here's a simple example where there are only two directions, x and y. You sum the square of the cosine of this angle, and you're supposed to get that answer. And you can generalize it to n dimensions or how many dimensions you want. Okay? So the idea is this probability is being assigned, the probability has been assigned to the squared direction cosine. So this is not quite the same as what you get for relative frequency kind of picture. Okay? So, and actually, people try to study to compare between these two, okay? And there are some modifications needed to be done so that classical probability looks like quantum probability and quantum probability looks like classical probability. Okay? Okay, so that's basically just the motivation. There are only two things, okay? Vector spaces and probabilities. Okay? So we go for vector spaces first. So in the case of quantum theory, what we call quantum states is actually not the same as a vector. And I mentioned that afterwards. So we talk about state vectors first, okay? And state vectors somehow represent quantum states, and they belong to some very some abstract complex vector space, meaning it's a vector space over a complex field. Okay? And these elements are denoted by this. I'm using direct Brouwer-Katz notation because I find that elegant. We can replace it by any other thing, but no, we're going to use that. So I have this cat vector, so to speak. Okay? And the set of these cat vectors obey the usual axioms of vector space. I suppose everyone knows about that. You can skip that. Right? So you have this commutativity of addition, this one, and then associativity, the null vector, and then inverse, additive inverse, and then scalar multiplication distributed for the addition, addition of scalars distributed for the scalar multiplication, identity, and that. Okay? So it's the usual thing that we see. Okay? Actually, I should mention the other thing. This is considered an abstract thing. It doesn't have any particular form until we give them. Okay, we'll see later on. Okay? And we need another thing besides the cat vector space. We need what we call the dual vector, which is actually what in the physics terminology we call it R vector. actually it comes from the idea of bracket. So you have this cat and the bra, okay? So the bra vectors also satisfy the axioms of vector space, and they form a different vector space, the dual space. Okay? So it's different from the one before. Now, why do we need this? Essentially, we need a way of representing something that we already know in terms of wave functions, which is correspond to the complex conjugate wave function. That is in terms of wave function. Another idea is simply to need to have a way of getting inner products. So you can have this vector space to be an inner product space. Okay, inner products are just generalization of scalar products. Okay, by the use of this graph. Okay, so an inner product between two cat vectors psi and phi that is defined to be the combination of bra cat. So you turn one of them, and this is actually depend on your convention. Okay, I take the second one, with the one taken the dual, so you get bra phi cat psi, and that bra cat combination give you a scalar, which is normally a complex number. Okay, and this another way of thinking about bra vectors is actually to think of them as a linear function of the cat. So what it does, this cat vector and this bra vector actually map elements of the cat vector space into the complex. And this linear functional, we give them this vector. Okay, so it's just linear functional. Okay, and this idea is useful when you talk about elements of infinite dimensional space. Okay. In the case of finite dimensional space, it's quite easy to associate a bra vector to a cat. But infinite dimensional space, you can't have that very easily. Okay, some of the properties of inner product. Okay, it's not the dot product, it's scalar product. Okay, so you get two vectors taking the scalar product, fine. So if you change the order, if it's no, it's a real vector space, you get the same thing. But this is in a complex vector space, so when you change the order, you get complex one. Okay, and then if you take the inner product of vector with inner combination of vectors, okay, then the inner products are distributes. Okay? You get this chi making this cat psi, then chi making this cat phi, so you get this. And if in the case that the inner product between phi and psi and phi, let us stick to the convention I'm using, the cat psi and phi to be equal to zero, then you say psi and phi to be orthogonal. Just like you have the normal inner product between the dot product between phi and j, for example. And one very useful thing of having an inner product is that you can find the length square of a vector. Okay? Just like you have v dot v gives you the modulus v squared. Okay? It's the same thing over here. So you get this inner product between psi and itself, it's being positive in the normal sense, but it can be zero if and only if that psi is actually the null one. That's the only exception. Otherwise, it's always equivalent. So with that, now we can actually find the norm, which is that thing is the length. The norm of a vector psi, denoted by this double line there, is the square root of the inner product. Okay? So that is just like the idea of a vector. Okay? And why we want to do that is simply we want to have the idea of the cat being normalized, meaning it gets to a new vector which has only unit length. Okay? We want to do that for physics. For mathematics, you don't need. Okay? And you also, remember I mentioned that the idea of properties in quantum mechanics is essentially based on directions. So you don't care about, you know, what's the magnitude of the question. You only need to make it, you know, you only need to know the information about the direction. Okay. And then one can actually, later on, you want to have a set of characters that are said to be orthogonal, meaning what? Meaning it's orthogonal, okay? That means you take a scalar product between two different vectors, it's orthogonal. But when it's within the same vector, you want it to be unit vector. So then it's called orthogonal.
Okay. If you're there.
Yes, that now.
No, the first one. Yeah. They can limit it to the kids, people that can spread it over.
This is what you call, what this is called? Cat vector.
Cat vectors. The brackets. The brackets.
This one.
So the ones when they were splitted. Are they all supposed to be to the right when you were splitting? Everything yeah. Was split.
Okay. The idea of essentially the idea of inner product. The idea of inner product is something like a map. You take two members of the vector space and you map it to a complex. So now, how are we going to do it? No, it depends on. You can just. Then, just like, for some of them talking about how do you multiply two matrices. So it's again that kind of thing. No, I can do this in a way that, okay, if I think of a vector like a column vector, later on we see that, okay, I can multiply two column vectors together if I want. But I'm going to make life complicated, like Toshi Samiden says. Okay, I'm going to use the normal rule of matrix method. If I want to create a number out of a column vector, what do I do? I multiply it with a row vector. Right? N, sorry, 1 by n times n by 1, so 1 by 1 matrix. Okay? So I'm making it less complicated in that sense. So in other words, when you have a row vector, it belongs to a different space, the dual space. But a column vector is belonging to another different space. So it's just, when it comes to matrix representation, it's quite easy to see. But no, it can be other things besides matrix representation. Okay. So I don't have to stand here, right? Okay, so now where, this is where we put more concrete form of this graph paper. Okay? So any vector space can automatically has a basis vector. Okay? So it's a finite dimensional space. So n dimension, for example, then you can find always n leading independent vectors. And once you find an n leading independent vectors, you can make it autonomous. By using branch pick procedure. Okay? But you're aware of some of this linear system. Okay. So what we do is, okay, we assume there is such a basis vector from 1 to n. Okay? And now you can say that in any general cat vector can be expanded in terms of basis. So I have this cat psi expanded in terms of this basis vector EI. So Ci is your coefficient expansion, okay? And I can actually find out what the expansion coefficient is. Okay. Maybe I'll show you just in the evening if people get tired. So what do you do? You just simply say, okay, I have psi. What I'm going to do, I'm just going to multiply the inner product of psi with Ej among the elements of the basis vector, and I know the basis vector are autonomous. Okay? So what I do here, I have, so now, space here. So, and you know how inner product is reduced? I can bring the sum up. And I can bring the scale up. So I get E, J, E, I. And this is autonomous. When J is not equal to I, is 0. Right? And when J equals I, it's 1. So it runs through all these different I's, 1 to N, but it only picks up 1. This is when I equals to J, becomes J. Okay? So basically, essentially what we have, Cj is now equal to this. So I know essentially a formula to find the expansion coefficient. Okay. The idea of how we differ from these two is through this basis. If I know, for example, this is an n-dimensional vector space, I can always define the basis in this n-dimensional vector spaces in terms of this column. Okay. So if you just plug it in into this formula, the cat vector just takes the column, the form of column. Okay. So now another thing that one needs to, maybe I show this again. This is when I teach it to undergraduate students, I always say this is the magic wand. So now you have this, Ej psi is equal to Cj. Okay, let's go back to the expansion thing. So I have this Ci, Ei, in sum of I. But I now I know what Ci is. So I just simply write it like this. What is it? Okay. Like this Ei psi. And here, so this is the number of Ci. Okay, and one of the things that you can actually do whenever you have this bracket together, it becomes a number. It's a scalar. Now, a scalar, it doesn't matter where you multiply, but it's at back or at front. So I can change this to the following. I'm just multiplying the scalar at the back. Okay? But now what happens over here? I'm writing psi in terms of psi. So in other words, this whole thing is just your identity. Okay? So this is what we call a unit. This is what we call the outer product. Bra cat is an inner product. Cat bra is what we call an outer product. Okay? You take this outer product of the basis and sum over all basis vectors. If it's complete, okay, then it should give you the identity. Now, the idea is quite simple. The outer product is actually a projection operator. Okay? What it does, okay, I take this vector psi, pointing in this direction, I'm going to project one on the x direction, one on the y direction, and one on the z direction. And then sum all those projections. If you sum all those projections, you'll get back your psi. That's what it is. So this is actually just projection of the vectors. It's a projection operator in the I direction. Okay. The story in quantum mechanics, when it gets difficult, when you need functional analysis, when it goes to infinite dimension. In finite dimensional space, this completeness relation can be easily tested. Okay. But in fact, infinite dimensional space is quite difficult because you need, when you have infinite sums, you need to make sure that the infinite sums converge. So you need the idea of Cauchy sequence. Again, I'm not going to go too much about this now. That means you can have this idea of vectors, sequence of vectors approaching each other. Okay. And then if there is a limit, okay, then that limit must be contained in the space itself. Okay. If it is not contained in the space itself, okay, then the vector space is called incomplete. If the limit is inside the space itself, then we call it a complete vector space. So we need to make sure that, you know, what you describe is a complete vector space. Essentially, that is related to this idea. Okay? And if it's complete and you have this inner product, then it's called a vector space. Okay? So in the case of finite dimensional, it is always complete. You don't really need to test. It's only in the case of, say, space of function, like you're doing a Fourier series kind of thing, then you have to make sure that, you know, things add up. Okay. So what is a quantum state? So a quantum state is essentially what we call an equivalence class of state vectors on the compact scalar mass. So it says, okay, what matters is only the directions. Okay. So that is in terms of how you're supposed to define a state. A state is like, you know, telling who you are in some sense. Okay? But the one that requires a bit more than this is essentially the idea of normalization. Okay? So when you normalize things, you actually encode probabilities inside. Okay? So essentially, you know, people write this down as a quantum state possibly. So that means the state of quantum system is holding some vector object that belongs to this complex space from which you can actually calculate the
problem. How about the wave function is not normalizable.
You mean like plane waves and things?
Well,
it is possible. We prefer actually try to do things with more. And they involve generalized functions, but I think I mentioned this in the third lecture. Okay, again, most of the time we are going to base ourselves with finite dimensional vectors. Okay, only in certain ideas I need to introduce ideas like, you know, what's the angular momentum later on. Okay, I need to go back to the idea of wave function, then I go back to that. But I'm not going to go into the function analysis. Now, the idea of this introduction of quantum mechanics is essentially to, later on we talk about quantum information, and quantum information mostly based on finite dimensional space. They can go to infinite if you want, but no. With finite dimensional inverse space, then you know, it's easy to manipulate. Okay? So the next thing is to do observer. Now, observers are essentially the physicist's very sophisticated way of saying a physical quantity. Okay. Now, why we don't want to use quantity? We'll learn that from Sim's school. Okay. We want to call it observer, something that you can observe. It doesn't need to be quantified. It just needs to be observed. Two different things. Okay. So in quantum theory, what it does is makes use of linear operators, the normal quantum mechanics. There is other versions of quantum mechanics called nonlinear quantum mechanics, which can make use of nonlinear operators. But for us, it's enough to do this. Okay? Linear operators, but the main I have this operator A that acts on vectors of the Hilbert space, and what it does, if it meets some superposition over here, a linear combination of psi and, sorry, I've forgotten the vertical line there, psi and pi, it simply, the action of operator just simply distributes about the edge. So it's just a linear. Now, that is with respect to this linearity in vector space. Okay. Not surprisingly, but no. Operators themselves have their own algebraic operations. Okay. I can do addition. I can add two operators together, which acts on the same Hilbert space, but it does, so they just simply distribute individual actions that add up. Okay. Or I can do scalar multiplication, and it does the same thing. Okay. This is the same thing like that same sort of linear space. In fact, linear operators form a linear or vector space themselves. Okay. But of course, operators does other than addition, scalar multiplication. They are multiplication of operators themselves. So you can multiply operators with another operator. Okay. You need more operators. But just like the case of the column vector for the cat vectors and row vector for the bar vectors, you can also associate a form to the operators. Okay? On its own, it's formless in some sense. Until you give it a form to the basis vector, then it requires some concrete form that can be done. Okay? So what do we do? And I'm using all these vertical lines. What we can actually do is to take this operator A, okay, and I'm going to multiply the identity operator there in front, multiply another identity operator at the back, okay, my magic one, okay, and then resolve, sometimes called resolution of identity, this completeness relation that we had before, okay, this one. This is the completeness relation that we had. It is sometimes called resolution of the identity. You resolve the identity according to the different projections. Okay? So I resolve the identity operator multiply in front, identity operator multiply in back. Okay? So I have two EIs, sum of I, then EJ, some OJ. Imagine that you have a vertical line. Okay? So what do I have? Well, remember, anything with a bracket closing up is a scale. So this thing is actually a scale. So it's a number. And that number is essentially what is known as the metric set. And what's the rest is EI EJ. Now, if you really give it a matrix form for those vectors, let me just do one. E1. So what's this? This is actually in terms of matrices. It's 1, 0, 0, 0, dot, 1, 0, 0, 0, dot.
So what? How can you multiply column vector with a row vector? You
know how to do row vector multiply column vector, right? Let's just straightforwardly think in terms of conformability of these two matrices. This is actually n by 1. This is actually 1 by n. So you can see this one and this one conforms to each other. So the resultant? N by n matrix, which is really 1. It's 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and the rest. Okay? So if you start multiplying E, I, E, J, each term, every time it picks up the I, J, add them up, so you have this N matrices, N squared terms, actually, N squared terms. So you have N squared matrices that you get. Okay, add them up, and you can get this thing. Okay. How long have you been time?
So this matrix is just a similar case of one of the EIJs in the multiplication of.
It will be multiplied with A11. So I'll get A11 here. And I'm going to add with A12, A13. And in the end, I get the whole function. So if you have not seen this kind of graph platform, it's very elegant. So what else do I need? Well, can we use operators to represent something physical for all operators? I'm afraid not. We have to have a very special operator to actually represent physical quantities.
Is
not equal to N. Okay. So just like you had this bracket rule for vectors, operators themselves, remember that operators actually forming vector spaces, they can have their own duals. And their dual is what we call the Hermitian conjugate or the adjoint. And if you have done matrix theory of matrices before, the adjoint is simply what? Complex conjugate transpose. And that's what it is. And in terms of if you have a much more general kind of vector spaces, this is the defining relationship. Okay? Earlier, if you remember the linear product, we mentioned that. We had that. It's coming from the same origin. Okay? So now instead of nothing in between, you put something in between. Okay? And you need to equate that. So this is the defining relation for the Hermitian conjugate, which is denoted by this A dagger. Okay. And this Hermitian conjugation operates the following properties. So you take the product of two operators, taking the adjoint, it would reverse the multiplication. If you take a scalar multiplied with this operator, and then take the adjoint, we'll give the adjoint for the operator, but for the scalar, we'll take the complex one. And we take the adjoint twice, we'll give back the operator. And in terms of the matrix element, is the thing that I mentioned before, the dagger or the solution conjugate operator is simply the operator, complex conjugated, and then transposed. Okay. So remember why we wanted to introduce this Hermitian conjugate is to say that, okay, for physical quantities of observable, really, okay, we need a special class of operators. And that class of operators are essentially what we call the Hermitian operator. What's a Hermitian operator? A Hermitian operator is one that obeys A dagger is in equal to A. Why is that important? Now we'll see that. You can actually do this as well. You can have an empty dimensional operator, and this A dagger gives you minus A. Okay? But our concern is actually Hermitian operators. But really, generally, an operator is neither Hermitian nor empty dimensional. Just like a complex number is neither real nor imaginary. It has both parts. So in fact, a complex number, you can actually find a complex number, the real part will be what? R z plus z bar, and in the imaginary part will be R z plus z bar. Add them up to get z. Okay. Same thing happens for the case of operators. You can do the same trick. So what happens over here, this is Hermitian, this is anti-Hermitian. So a Hermitian operator has matrix elements satisfying that. Okay. So if you look at the I element, what's going to happen? A star II equals to AII. Z star equals Z, what is it in? It means it's a real number. So, already I've already looking that, that the permission operator is the same thing as the physical function. So, okay? Now, consider this 2A and B permission. Another quantity of importance, remember that you sometimes you need to make products of operators, but you know that the product of operators, if you change the order, it can be something else. Okay? So sometimes you need to know what's the difference between the two, and this is called the commutator. So AB square bracket, AB is what? AB minus B. And you start in your A and B permission, apparently the commutator will become anti-permission. You can actually prove this. It's quite straightforward algebra. Now, this is actually important for us. In particular, we have this fundamental commutator in quantum mechanics. This is a position, this is a momentum. Okay? And position being something physical, it's supposed to be Hermitian. Momentum is something physical, Hermitian. So, essentially, you take the commutator, it will be an anti-Hermitian operator. Now, where's the anti-Hermitian coming in? It's reflected to this I. And why is commutator actually important? I don't actually put this in my lecture notes because I thought that would go to something else. Is commutator is going to give you all this uncertainty principle. Have you heard about uncertainty principle? So the commutator is directly relevant to that. Right. So the cap vector is said to be an eigenvector of A, okay, if it has this particular information. Okay? That means you take A acting on this vector, this specific vector, you give it a number times specific vector. Okay? This really is the same kind of problem that you find in matrices. Remember that the operators themselves have matrix representations. Okay? So you start by finding eigenvalues on the matrix. Okay? So so here is an eigenvector that corresponds to this is what we call the eigen values. Now sometimes you can find that different eigenvectors have the same eigenvalues, and this is what we call degenerate. And later on we talk about degeneracy. Where do you find them? If they are all different, then that's what we call non-degenerate. Okay. Another thing that probably you want to know is for looking the dual of this thing is actually equal to that. So in other words, this lambda is converted to again latex. Supposed to be a bra, right? That's a fit. So and your lambda here turns into a complex one. Now notice that also that the dual of this. Okay, for the bra, you don't have A, but you have A like this. Suppose I know what is this, automatically I should know what this is. Okay, but I will not know what this is. Okay. So these are things that is important when you do calculation. Okay, so the typical problem in quantum theory is that to solve eigenvalues and eigenvectors. That's the whole thing. So here's some theorem. I'm trying to place the mathematician up to the theorem. Okay. So eigenvalues or Hermitian operators are real, and the eigenvectors of A corresponding to different eigenvalues are solid. Actually, this is quite general. You can also, but the orthogonality also works for other kind of operators. Okay. other one too. Yeah. But the pool, the sketch of the pool. So the important part of this journal is that this real argument. So what's going to happen is that the real eigenvalues of the operator is going to represent the values that you find in measurements. And what do you find in measurements? When you measure something, you measure those with real life, real values, real numbers. So you want to make these real numbers correspond to the real eigenvalues of this dimension of. And again, this this correspondent is not. Automatic. It's a postulate. It's some assumption. You have this linkage between the two. Yeah, yeah. Reality of argument is for dimension operators. They carry specific information about operator. That's why when you do measurement, you know, once you measure the thing, you know a specific information about what. So this reality of these eigenvalues and the reality of the measurement values, you just need them to correspond. So essentially, that's why I say permission operators are the ones that represent the second implication is this, the orthogonality of the eigenvalues. Now, once you have a set of orthogonal eigenvectors or orthogonal vectors, then you know that that set going to be a linear independent set. It's automatic, it's orthogonal. And that's good, because linear independence are the things that we want for basis. Okay? So if this eigenvectors of a particular operator is complete, that's all we need. Okay? So essentially, the eigenvectors will be the one that be the candidates for this basis vector that you want to investigate in some. Actually, okay, I'm telling you half of the story, because essentially, if you want complete information about a system, you need an infinite dimensional Hilbert space, because you want to know about the position. But sometimes you don't want to know about position. Sometimes you just want to know about energy. Once you need to know about energy, you can actually reduce the kind of information that you want to manipulate. So here's the postulate. Observers are represented by subdimension, in this case, dimension. Okay? Operators, acting on vectors and Hilbert space. And then there are eigenvalues from the measurement. So there are some. If you have a function of observer, just like, say, momentum, I want kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is given by p squared on 2m. It's a quadratic function. So I just replace whatever operator representing momentum, square, and divide by 2m. But not all observers are going to be represented by operators in the non-trivial sense. There are cases where you just represent it by trivial operators, such like the mass. The mass is actually represented by the mass times the identity. So you just have multiplying it down. So you don't need all observables to have non-trivial operators. Okay, now going to the problem. So remember that once you normalize things, I said that's going to be the thing giving you the ideal problem. How is it? Okay, let's suppose we have an observer, and we have the set of eigenvectors, and the eigenvectors is complete. So you can now expand any vector, any state vector, in terms of this basis, in this coefficient, right? And I normalize it, so that it has unit length, and that unit length has this kind of idea. So what is, if I expand this idea of unit length, so it comes here, let me write it up. It's supposed to be this. So 1 equals norm equals to, actually, this. non-square, okay, I'm using non-square. Again, there are mistakes in my metronome when I'm typing out the first. So what is that? I'll get this thing. Remember that this is actually what? This is actually this. Okay? The non-square is essentially your inner product for the vector itself. That's the length square. Okay? But now what I do, I insert an identity in between, right? And I know how to resolve identity. So I get this, and this is, you know, this is complex conjugate of that. So that's why I get that square. And what happens is that now I can think of this thing as like this is something positive, sum up. Okay? It's like that the sum of probabilities equals 1. Okay? So in other words, I can identify the idea of probability with this non-square with respect to a particular component. Okay? And interpret it as what? Okay, remember that phi I is supposed to correct onto this lambda I, and lambda I is something that you can actually measure in an experiment. So that operator A. So it's like, okay, what is this? Really the probability of measuring lambda I when the state is actually psi. And you sum it up, the total. Okay. So that's where property comes in. Now it comes a bit more mechanical. So when you have a probabilistic theory, can you actually do prediction? Well, one of the kind of prediction that can do is mean values. Okay. So I do a mean value. And in physics, we call it expectation value. So in the case of this operator A just now, I just multiply the eigenvalues, kind of value that I'm supposed to get. Okay, with the problem. So I get that. But now I can turn this thing into this form. Okay, and this lambda I can be obtained by A at the phi R. So I replace by that. But now, with that, okay, I can collect this phi I, which is like the resolution of identity. Okay? So I collect that, and I get this one. And this is precisely the form, the general form that we want when we calculate expectation. This one is quite special because I'm using the operators that correspond to this. That has this eigenvectors in it, but generally it works. Okay, that final form works for any kind of sign without the expansion. Okay? Again, this is a positive. Okay. Finally, the final thing that we need in the theory is the idea of dynamics. If we know something now, but you cannot know anything else in the future. It's not really a useful theory. You can discuss things at present. Okay? So you want a theory which is not giving you prediction. So we need the idea of theory like an equation of motion or some kind of evolution equation. So we need the idea of time somehow. Maybe I just mentioned the important thing. The important thing is the idea of Hamiltonian. And generally, this is given by the total energy. Okay, the total energy is here, this is here, kinetic energy plus potential energy. And this generates the time translation. So it tells you how to evolve your state vector into the future. And how is it evolved? It's through this Schrodinger equation. Okay. So I'm going to cut it, not algebra.
So that's what the algebra is. Well, again, this is quite good.
One of the things I can do is actually to separate out the time dependent. Okay? So So I can do that when the system is a closed quantum system. And when you have a closed quantum system, you know physically, if the time physics is going to find a way, okay, thank you, then your energy is actually conserved. Okay? So you can have an energy conserved, then you can actually know write this thing down. And I'm going to skip it there. Okay, so essentially your time dependent Schrodinger expression, but you give you a simpler equation called a time independent Schrodinger equation. Time independent Schrodinger equation is essentially what? It's an eigen equation. Here you have an operator acting on a vector, gives you an eigen value, multiplying the vector. So it's an eigen value problem. And these kind of states are what we call stationary states because of this, you have the state of system in a stationary state, which is the eigen state of a Hamiltonian. All the predictions in the future is the same. It doesn't change. But once you say that, okay, the quantum system is not in the eigen state of the Hamiltonian, and it's not in the stationary state. I mean, if it's not in the stationary state, what does it mean? It means I'm going to have a state which is a superposition of the energy eigen state. So, you know, you can have different components of that. Eigenstates of energy. And when you do that, your expectation value of some observer will oscillate. Okay? Okay, this is actually an example. Since I have only five more minutes or less, this is an example of how you actually use algebra to actually solve problems without solving differential equations. So what do you do? Okay, here's a famous problem. It's the so-called standard problem of quantum mechanics to solve harmonic oscillator. And harmonic oscillator has this Hamiltonian that comes in sum of two squares. And you know, sum of two squares, you know how the difference of two squares, right? A squared minus B squared, you can factorize it. A plus B. How to factorize A squared plus B squared? A plus IB, A minus IB. So we want to do something similar with respect to the operator. Okay? So when you do that, we get new operators instead of using the P and X. I'm going to explain it into other kind of operators called annihilation and creation. And you can play around with this operator, the algebra of this operator. Here's an algebra of the operator, here's the commutator again, you get a simpler thing. What happened now?
Excuse me, he asked me to stop.
And I may just try to, no, I'm not going to go to the test, just to let you know how we do the algebra, how we utilize algebra to solve this. So you do that, okay? And then you say, okay, this is the thing I mentioned just now, we factorize things, but we don't quite get back the Hamilton. We get something extra. Okay? Because unlike numbers, your AB can cancel, okay? You have AB times B, AB, and then another term will be BA, but AB equals B is for numbers, but not for operators. So we define this idea of this thing is actually proportional to, linearly proportional to h. So we define a new operator called number operator, and then we, you know, if we know how to find the spectrum of this operator, then we'll be able to find the spectrum of the energy. Okay. So we use all these algebraic things. So again, commutative algebra. And here you can see that, okay, this is related to, again, a different kind of eigenvector. So the annihilation actually destroys one quanta of energy. Creation operator creates quanta of energy. And then you need to normalize things to get that. Finally, okay, we are going to get automatically your ground state. And then once you have a ground state, you can create quanta of energy by applying the creation operator each time. So when you do the creation operator, you apply creation operator in discrete number of ways. So in the end, your spectrum is actually quantized. It is labeled by the integer n. And this is done with solving any differential equation. You can solve the Schrodinger equation. You use Fermat polynomials and blah, blah, blah. But those are actually unnecessary.
Here's a matrix element again. Let's show you the kind of matrix element. So here is the Hamiltonian, the eigenvalues. But the eigenvalue is actually not defined there. Yeah. And then the x actually is a combination of A and A dagger. So you have all these quantities now actually represented by infinite matrices, infinite dimensions. And you can create good predictions. Expectation values. And this is the expectation value for the particular eigenstate n. Here's my references. This is quite a good book. It's a small book. Three sessions. My external examiner, my PhD. Okay. And then Sakurai and then Perez. I think I'll stop here for a small break of 10 minutes. In the meantime, the break, you can ask questions if you want.